My brief is to talk on what has changed in hepatitis C in children, and I would talk about the year 2018. So certain facts about hepatitis C. We know that about 13.2 million children are infected with hepatitis C worldwide. The main routes of transmission have been thought to be vertical. About two-thirds or more than two-thirds have a vertical transmission. And it has also been shown that those with a vertical transmission have a much higher spontaneous clearance rate as compared to the other modes of transmission. IV drug abuse in adolescents is the other means of transmission. And in Egypt, which is incidentally the country with the highest prevalence of hepatitis C, has been attributed to injections of tartar taken for treatment of schistosomiasis. So there it was these injections which are a cause of hepatitis C, both in adults and children. And in developing countries like ours, we have iatrogenic transmission, certain traditional practices like circumcision, scarification, etc. So vertical, yes, but there are other modes of transmission as well. Now, a much higher incidence has been seen in those who have been treated for malignancy. We get many children who are survivors of childhood cancers who come with hepatitis C. Renal failure patients requiring hemodialysis are a definite high-risk group, and thalassemics is something which is, in our country, one of the common group of children with hepatitis C. So talking of spontaneous hepatitis C clearance, in the vertically acquired group, up to 25% can clear the virus, and there's some data to suggest that the genotype 3, incidentally in India, 1 and 3 are the common genotypes. We have 4, 6 also, which are seen in certain parts of India, like the north, east and north. But for all practical purposes, it's 3 in the north, 1 in the south, and in Maharashtra, it would be a mix of both. So 1 and 3 is what we'll be primarily talking about, that about up to 1/4 of them will have a spontaneous clearance. When we talk of hepatitis C in general, it's about 80% who will continue to become chronic carriers and 20% will have a spontaneous clearance, but it's a little higher in those who acquire hepatitis C vertically. Now, this is important. If you have a positive mother whom you're following up, the anti-HCV antibody, which is the screening antibody in serum, would remain positive for 18 months. So there's no point in trying to test the child early because it's a passive transfer of antibody and it is a false positive. It does not imply hepatitis C infection. On the other hand, if the child is positive in the first year of life, then there is a lesser chance of clearance, especially if the HCV RNA is positive. So in this elegant study, it was seen that of the 266 children who had a vertically acquired infection, 17% cleared it by 2 years and 24 to 25% by 3 years. So the moral of this study is that wait for 3 years after birth if you're wanting to treat, because there's a good chance that about 1/4 of them would clear the virus. Now, what about hepatitis C related disease in children? As a fact, since Dr. Malti spoke so elegantly about hepatitis B, just to know that when you have hepatitis B infection, it takes about 5 to 7 years in those who are going to become chronic to develop cirrhosis. As against this, in hepatitis C, it's typically 15 to 20 years for cirrhosis or even more to develop. So the risk of cirrhosis in a child up to 18 years of age is small compared to adults, because it, even if it's vertically transmitted, it takes longer for them to develop cirrhosis compared to hepatitis B. Bridging inflammation and severe inflammation seen up to 15%. And hepatocellular carcinoma, which is the next stage of cirrhosis, sometimes you can have tumors even in the absence of cirrhosis, but that's unusual. Then, therefore, hepatocellular carcinoma in children is a rare disease. And therefore, we are not so worried about hepatocellular carcinoma. However, there are subsets where we'll be have to be more careful. Now, my talk will be based mainly on the ISPGHAN, the European Society of Pediatric Gastroenterology, Hepatology and Nutrition guidelines for treatment of hepatitis C, which came out in March 2018 this year. So, what does ISPGHAN say? Whom to treat? The rationale for treatment of adults with chronic infection is also valid for children. So, we need to treat all because hepatitis C is going to lead to cirrhosis and hepatocellular carcinoma. So, it says that treat all or at least consider all for treatment with hepatitis C, all children. It is not necessary to do a liver biopsy for obtaining liver tissue and it's not routinely indicated. Now, which is the subset you need to treat without any delay? Those who have significant fibrosis and cirrhosis, those with extra hepatic manifestations. We know that hepatitis C has extra hepatic manifestations like membranous membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, immune thrombocytopenia, cryoglobulinemia, etc. So those with extra hepatic manifestations need treatment early. And there is a subset where you have rapid evolution of disease, not the typical 15 to 20 years. Those who are recipients of solid organ or hematopoietic stem cell transplants and those on immunosuppressive treatments are the ones who are at high risk of rapid progression and need to be treated early. Where can you defer treatment? In those who are less than 12 years of age, because the only treatment approved as of today for this subgroup of less than 12 is still interferon and ribavirin, which was the standard of care until a year ago in children. So certain key publications are on adolescents, more than 12 to less than 18 years of age, where in genotype 1, this study of 100 patients used sofosbuvir. So most of the studies I'm going to talk about are sofosbuvir based because that is what is available in India. So that's the key molecule, and then you have add-ons like ledipasvir for genotype 1 and daclatasvir for genotype 3. So this study was mainly in non-cirrhotics using these two. Very SVR is sustained virological response, which is a response 3 months after stopping treatment. So if a patient remains negative for 3 months after stopping treatment, it is called a sustained virological response, and these are the patients who are very unlikely to relapse. Again, I want to emphasize that unlike hepatitis B, where you almost, if you treat them, you almost need to treat them for life, for hepatitis C, the difference is that you treat them for a very limited fixed period and you're assured of a good undetectable virus almost for the rest of the life if they have achieved a sustained virological response. What about genotype 2 and 3, 52 patients where sofosbuvir with ribavirin was used, and if there was cirrhosis or genotype 3, then the extension of treatment went on to 6 months instead of the usual 3 months, and again here there was a pretty good response rates of 97% for genotype 3. I'll skip this just to say that even in genotype 4, there was a very good response in these studies, mainly from Egypt, which is the main genotype there. So what does ISPGHAN say about treatment of adolescents? Peg interferon and ribavirin are not recommended, especially in those which are more than 12 years of age, because you're talking of adolescents. For geno 1 and 4, sofosbuvir and ledipasvir in the doses mentioned for those who are more than 35 kilos of weight. If they're treatment naive, 12 weeks, if they're treatment experienced, that means they've been treated with interferon before and now have relapsed or and have cirrhosis, then you extend the treatment. So the basis is very clear. If a patient is a one who's likely to not respond very well, you either add ribavirin or you extend treatment from 3 months to 6 months. For genotype 2 and 3, sofosbuvir and ribavirin, that is because that is the only study which was done when ISPGHAN 2018 guidelines came about. And they say for 3, again, the 3 is a little less responsive genotype. You extend treatment for 24 weeks. What about interferon-based treatment, which we are familiar with? For those less than 12 years of age, we know that interferon plain was used. We don't use it anymore. But pegylated interferon, either alpha 2A or 2B, once a week, given for as long as 24 weeks for Geno 3 and 48 weeks for Geno 1 have been used along with ribavirin, and they have a whole list of side effects which I'm not going to dwell into, but we are all familiar with the side effects of interferon, and these are all the interferon studies. So if you see here for Geno 3, the response rates with interferon are not bad. These are around 90%, and if you see for Geno 1, they are around 50%. These are various studies in interferon. So what do we learn from here? That if you actually look at children and see the response rate with interferon-based therapy, whether it is always addition of ribavirin was better than no ribavirin, but if you see the response rates, they are much better in both interferon with ribavirin and peg interferon with ribavirin compared to what was seen in adults. But the side effects are there. Now, this was one study which looked at children less than 12 years of age. We don't have any ESPGHAN guidelines on this, but I thought it's important to mention this study. They used sofosbuvir and ledipasvir for those less than 12 from age 6 onwards, and they found most of them were genotype 1. And this was a multi-center study at 31 sites from Australia, New Zealand, UK and US. There was only one patient who was treatment experienced and cirrhotic, and there were only two patients with genotype 3. All were given the same drug except the Geno 3, where ribavirin was added. And what did they find? That the drug combination was safe. It could be used in all these genotypes. And they used a half-strength tablet for this subset of patients who were without cirrhosis or had compensated cirrhosis. Incidentally, there are no studies for decompensated cirrhosis in children or adolescents. And look at the response rates, very good, except in the first group, it was just one patient had a relapse. So what is ESPGHAN saying about children less than 12 years? Currently, peg interferon and ribavirin is the only approved treatment, but you could consider off-label use of DAAs based on the need and the severity of the disease. What about special population? Thalassemia major is what we have seen a lot. There are no guidelines in children. They are mainly extrapolated from adults. And we know that the prevalence of Hep C is very high, almost up to 64% in these patients. And what is a peculiar problem with this subgroup? They have iron overload, and this iron overload adds to the rapid progression of fibrosis in hepatitis C, and we've had 10-year-olds with cirrhosis in this subgroup. So here, the progression is much faster, and EASL 2000, that is the European Society of Study of Liver, says that you should treat these patients just like you would treat other hepatitis C patients. And this is a study which is just been accepted and has gone online from our center, where we looked at 18 patients of thalassemia major and hepatitis C. These were adolescents. We've published a study in adults. And 15 years were the mean age. 12 had Geno 1, 5 Geno 3, and 1 was undetermined. 6 of these had cirrhosis. None were decompensated, and 1 was treatment experienced. And we found 89% response rate. And that 2 were not included in the SVR because 1 was non-compliant, did not finish treatment. The other 1 had end of treatment response but succumbed before we could assess the 3-month SVR. There were no major side effects. And this is a whole list of ongoing trials, but I think this is the one we need to look for, because this is looking at sofosbuvir and velpatasvir, which is now available in India in the age group of 3 to 17. Now, this is a study which is again online, not yet published, from Punjab, Dr. Deeman's group from PGI Chandigarh. We know that you've seen Urta Punjab, and you know that how the hepatitis C prevalence is the highest in the country because of IV drug abuse. So 3.2%, otherwise it's 0.3% prevalence in Punjab, and there is the Mukhmantri Punjab Hepatitis C Relief Fund, which was launched in June 2016 with the goal of eliminating hepatitis C in the next 10 years. Hepatitis C genotype was not done in these patients because it was thought that SOFO with Dacla would be pan-genotypic, especially in those without cirrhosis. In those with cirrhosis, the genotype was done. They analyzed 57 adolescents who had completed treatment, and look at this. It was not vertical transmission. 55% of the patients had hepatitis C from unsafe medical practices, 11% from IV drug abuse, and 2.7% from previous surgery. Just last two slides. All non-cirrhotics were given SOFO and Dacla for 12 weeks. In cirrhosis, the genotype was tested. If more than 35 kg, full dose. If less than 35 kg, half dose. And SVR was achieved in more than 98%, both in genome 1 and 3. There were no serious side effects. So I'd like to conclude by saying that we have a cure for hepatitis C in children now. And though the FDA has not yet approved DAAs for those less than 12, we have good studies to show that they are safe and can be used, and we are awaiting the approval very soon. So for adolescents, sofosbuvir and ledipasvir for geno 1, SOFO and ribavirin for geno 2 and 3 has been approved. Preliminary data with daclatasvir in both adolescents and less than 12 years of age seems that it is safe even in children, and in those less than 12 years we should be using half dose. And in the subset that which we see, thalassemia in adolescents is a fair response rate of about 90%. And soon I think interferon and ribavirin would go out of vogue as a standard of care for treating patients with hepatitis C, especially the pediatric population. Thank you.
Dr. Aabha, for your comprehensive speech.